This is Sea Change Radio, covering the shift to sustainability. I'm Alex Wise.
The company NextEra Energy put a video up on YouTube of my trip to this, to climbing up the top of this wind turbine. And in the interview, I said, you know, the race fans will forgive me for being an environmentalist because I'm a race car driver. And the first comment that was posted underneath it was an environmentalist saying, you know, I'll forgive you for being a race car driver because you're an environmentalist. So I'm sort of being forgiven from both sides and hopefully become a bridge for these two different groups to start talking to each other.
Auto racing, also known as burning tons of fossil fuel to drive really fast in circles, has got to be one of the most environmentally unfriendly uses of a motor vehicle. But both of today's guests on Sea Change Radio are professional race car drivers who, despite being at opposite ends of the political spectrum, are both trying to spread their eco-friendly messages to 75 million racing fans, perhaps not the most receptive audience. First, we speak to Leilani Munter, an up-and-coming driver on the ARCA stock car racing circuit. Munter's a politically liberal, vegetarian, and self-proclaimed hippie chick who's tapping into a whole new set of green sponsors for her racing team. Then we hear from Ward Burton, who spent 17 years as a NASCAR driver. Burton's a political conservative who now heads the Ward Burton Wildlife Foundation and is trying to turn kids onto hunting and fishing to help cure what he calls a nature deficit disorder plaguing the next generation of American adults. My guest today on Sea Change Radio is Leilani Munter. She's a race car driver and environmental activist. Leilani, welcome to Sea Change Radio.
Hi, great to be here.
It's a pleasure to have you on the show. First, tell our listeners a little bit about your racing career.
So I've been racing now for 10 years. I earned a degree in biology from the University of California in San Diego, and then I went racing like most biology graduates. And I've been doing it ever since. I've kind of been working my way up the levels of NASCAR. I did a little bit of Indy Lights racing back in 2007, but most of my career has been in stock cars. I'm now racing in what's called the ARCA series, which is a development league of NASCAR. And I work with eco-friendly sponsors. I lobby for clean energy. I've been doing that since 2008. Since 2007, I've been adopting and protecting an eco rainforest every time I race. And my goal is to really use my race car to talk to those 75 million race fans in the U.S. and, you know, get them to think twice about the choices they make every day and the impact that it has on our world.
Yes, it's definitely not preaching to the choir, I can imagine.
Exactly. Yeah, I do a lot of environmental speeches, and, you know, there are often times that earth events and clean energy events and solar events. And it's great. It's great to be around other people that think like I do. But at the same time, to create change, you really have to start a dialogue with the people who are not on board with you. And it's a more difficult dialogue to have, but it's really the most important one because that's the only way we're going to change people's minds.
For somebody who cares deeply about the environment and studied biology in college, there's that paradox between racing cars, something that you usually don't associate with environmental activism, and somebody who's giving speeches and trying to make people aware of climate change. But how do you square that paradox in your mind?
Yeah, you know, they're really inseparable for me, my environmental work and the racing. The racing is really what gives me a platform to talk to the race fans. You know, like I said, it's the number one spectator sport in America. There's 75 million of them. And they really need to be hearing this message, and they're not really hearing this message because there aren't a whole lot of other race car drivers out there trying to get them to listen to these issues. So the companies that partner with me and sponsor me are all green companies.
For example?
At Daytona last year, I had actually six companies on my car. I had Native Energy, which does a lot of wind power. I had Grow Solar, which is a residential solar company. I had Green and Save, which is a parent company of LED Saving Solutions, which does LED lighting retrofits, and Eco Academy, which is a green jobs training program. And all of these different companies basically came together to get my car on the track. And actually, the vice president of Native Energy wrote a really great blog on their website kind of addressing this issue, because he had a customer that was so upset that, you know, how can you be on a race car? But the thing is, you know, that's really what gives me my voice. That's what gets me to be able to go to D.C. and sit down with senators and the decision makers in D.C. and you know, talk to them about our clean energy issues that we have. If I were to stop racing, I wouldn't take a race car off of the track. There would still be 43 cars start that race no matter what. I just wouldn't be one of them, and I wouldn't be there, you know, representing these green companies. I wouldn't be, you know, there probably wouldn't be another driver replacing me that has been adopting an acre of rainforest every time they sit in the car. I think it's really important to have this conversation. And my last sponsor at Kansas Speedway was a group of veterans from Iraq and Afghanistan. They're a group called Operation Free, and they are fighting for clean energy. These veterans are trying to send the message to America that our dependence on foreign oil to the tune of $1 billion a day is a national security threat. And when we were at Kansas Speedway, we had a display up. We had veterans. I think we had like 10 veterans there with me. And we had 30,000 NASCAR fans come through our tent to talk to us about these clean energy issues. So it's really the racing that gives me a voice.
Now, when you speak to racing fans who don't get your message, where do you think they're coming from?
When I have the people come on, like, my Facebook or whatever, and they're, like, you know, hardcore Republicans, and they're basically coming on to yell at the other environmentalists on my site. I always say, you know, how can anybody really argue with trying to keep our environment clean, trying to keep the air clean, the water clean, not spending $1 billion a day on foreign oil? I mean, nobody has a comeback for that, because there is no comeback for that. I mean, it just makes total sense.
Yeah, it's definitely not seeing the forest through the trees kind of mentality.
Right. And the thing that they, you know, this whole drill, baby, drill thing, it's like, you know, my response to that is always, if you look at the oil reserves that the United States has, we have enough on and offshore to last us for 3.5 years with our current rate of consumption. And then we'll be out completely.
Now the race is on, and here comes pride up the backstretch. Heartaches are going to the inside. Hot tears are holding back. They're trying not to fall. My heart's out of the running. For another's sake, the race is on, and it looks like heartaches, and the winner loses all.
This is Alex Wise on Sea Change Radio. My guest is race car driver and environmental activist Leilani Munter. Can you talk about the work you do with clean energy and renewable fuels?
It's obviously a huge issue. We have the technology to put in smart grid technology, to be using wind and solar and hydropower and geothermal to be powering electric cars. I think that that is really the future. And, you know, as a race car driver, I was really happy when NASCAR announced that they were at least using a 15% biofuel mix, which for them is, you know, a big step. IndyCar's been on 100% biofuels for many years now. And the American Le Mans series is doing something pretty cool where they've got a green racing challenge where they've actually got different teams using different renewable fuels. So there's one team using cellulosic ethanol made from wood chips. There's another team using algae-based biodiesel. So I think it's a, you know, racing can also be used to innovate and to, you know, work on these fuels, and you have these amazing engineers that can work on energy efficiency and fuel efficiency. And, we need to use those brains to help us, develop new technologies that we can then use in our streetcars. And I think, you know, racing has for many years been at the forefront of innovation that ends up in your streetcar. So a lot of the safety things that you see in your car, like the mirrors and things like that, that all came from racing. So keep in mind that the sport also has a great function and that it's got brilliant people that work on these race cars that can help us, you know, learn how to use biofuels more efficiently.
We've profiled several advanced biofuel companies, such as ones that make fuel from algae and wood chips and sugar cane. But a lot of the problems they have going to market are cutting through a lot of the regulatory issues and hurdles to become a widespread fuel. But I can imagine one of the advantages that the racing industry has is they can kind of regulate themselves in terms of what they put in their cars, right?
Exactly. Yeah. And I really like that the Le Mans series has taken a lead on that. You know, because I don't race in that series and I race in a NASCAR oriented series, you know, we all have to use whatever fuels that NASCAR mandates. So this year was the first time that they made the step. It's only a 15% mix, but I think you'll see that increase. And, you know, I'm hoping here in the next year or so, you'll see them on 100% biofuel. NASCAR's made some great strides. They hired a guy that's, you know, basically trying to reduce the carbon footprint of the sport. And Pocono International Raceway just opened a 3-megawatt solar farm last summer. The racetrack itself only uses 1 megawatt of power, so they're putting 2 megs back into the grid, and they're now the largest solar-powered sports facility in the entire world. So don't underestimate that the sport can't evolve and change.
And for our listeners around the country who aren't as familiar with the tiered system with NASCAR, can you tell us how soon can we be expecting to see you on our TVs in a NASCAR event?
Well, the series that I race in is already airing on Speed Channel, so you can watch. There'll be 10 races that we're hoping to run next year, and there's, I think, 7 or 8 more left this year in the ARCA series. Those all air live on Speed Channel, which is available, I think, in like 75 million homes, so most people can find it. I would move from ARCA after this. I would like to be in the Nationwide Series by 2013. That's NASCAR Nationwide, which is the second level, second highest level of NASCAR, and probably spend a couple years there. And I'd love to, you know, that would, I guess, be a 5-year plan that in 5 years I could be in Sprint Cup.
This is Alex Wise on Sea Change Radio. My guest is race car driver and environmental activist Leilani Munter. Leilani, we've had Luis Ahoyas on the show. He is the director and producer of The Cove, the Oscar-winning documentary that tells about the dolphin slaughter in Taiji, Japan. And you became involved in that fight against dolphin slaughter as well. Can you tell us a little bit more about your activities?
Right. As soon as I saw the movie, I knew that I wanted to help Rick. And we actually flew over. I've been to Taiji twice now. I went in September, on September 1st of last year, which is when the slaughter begins. It goes from September until March every year. And I delivered with Rick O'Berry. We delivered the petition that if you watch the movie, at the end of the movie, they'll tell you to, you know, go online and sign this petition asking Japan to end this dolphin slaughter. And then I went back again in October, and I stayed for a couple of weeks, and I actually filmed 2 dolphin slaughters while I was there. And, you know, it's just an awful thing to see. But the pressure that's happening in Taiji has really escalated, I think, since the movie won the Academy Award. I think many more people are now aware of what's happening in that little cove, that little tiny fishing village. And when I was there, you know, I was seeing activists from all over the world were showing up. There were people from Hong Kong and Germany and Australia and New Zealand, and they were all coming to Taiji to kind of protest against what was happening there. So we're actually organizing right now. On June 21st, we're going to have a screening of The Cove in San Rafael at the Rafael Film Center. And Luis Ahoyas will be there, the director, to speak. Rick O'Berry, the activist in the film, that's kind of the star of the film, he will also be there to talk. And my brother-in-law, Bob Weir, who many of you will probably know from his singing and guitar playing with the Grateful Dead and Rat Dog and Further, he will also be there and play a song after the film happens. And I think it's just going to be a wonderful event. So I'm just trying to do everything I can to keep it in people's minds that just because the movie's not in theaters anymore doesn't mean that the slaughter has ended.
Well, we'll link to that event on Sea Change Radio as well. And it sounds like not only educational, but a lot of fun.
Yeah, thank you. I appreciate that.
Well, we appreciate the work that you're doing. Some may say from the inside out, from you're going into the heart of darkness and you're bringing a lot of light. And we appreciate the work that you do. Leilani Munter, thanks so much for being my guest on Sea Change Radio.
Thank you. It was a pleasure.
Here he comes, here comes Speed Racer. He's a demon on wheels. He's a demon and he's gonna be chasing after someone. He's gaining on you, so you better look alive. He's busy revving up the powerful Mach 5. And when the odds are against him and there's dangerous work.
To listen to Sea Change Radio anytime, anyplace, just subscribe to our free podcast. Simply follow the link from seachangeradio.com or search for us in the iTunes podcast directory.
So my guest on Sea Change Radio is Ward Burton. After a 17-year NASCAR career as a driver, he is now a well-known conservationist and is the founder of the Ward Burton Wildlife Foundation. Ward, thanks so much for taking the time and being on Sea Change Radio.
Well, thank you for the invite.
So a lot of people who are involved in the environmental movement don't know much about race car driving, and they're, a lot of people think of them at odds, but it was a fairly smooth transition for you to get into environmental causes after NASCAR. Can you tell us when you began the Burton Wildlife Foundation?
Sure. You know, I was brought up with two paths and two passions in my life, and it was the outdoors through hunting and fishing with my granddad and other role models, and then I raced on in the summertime, and so those two paths were pretty much my whole life. And when I started having success as a NASCAR driver, when I won my first Cup race at Rockingham, North Carolina, in '96, I formed the foundation. I started to have some resources in order to try to give back to something that I hold so dear. So the two have never been separate to me. I just use one to give myself a voice for the other. And I'm not a, you know, got to be real careful labeling me as an environmentalist. I'm very concerned about our environment, but I'm more concerned with protecting our rural culture and having you know, leaders that understand our natural environment, but also understand that the sportsmen in the world are the true conservationists, and find ways to support one of us and keep that culture alive. That's what I'm all about. So I'm not a, I do forestry management on our 2,000 acres and a lot of different habitat work, and understand that a well-managed piece of property is better than a piece of property that's just left alone and kind of abandoned.
And is that the main focus of the Ward Burton Wildlife Foundation, is managing that property? Or?
Well, I put together 2,000 acres that a dear friend of mine, C.R. Sanders, owned half of that, and that was mine as well as his children and a bunch of other kids' outdoor playground as growing up that he allowed us to use. I actually lived on that farm between college and getting into racing in a log cabin, kind of went back to what I knew the best was outdoors, and you know, that was really important for me to save that piece of property and add to it in perpetuity through conservation easements. But we have a lot of other things going on. We do things with American heroes, using the outdoors to give them a day of comradeship and a day of saying thank you for what their sacrifice for us as Americans. We do grade school events with a lot of younger adults, younger kids, trying to introduce them to the natural environment and why it's important and the role that we play. We have a program called ACUB in Virginia where it's a contract with the U.S. Army, and that's putting conservation easements for landowners around one of our largest military training bases called Fort Pickett. And so we're actually the prime partner on that project. So we have a lot going on, and we actually hold conservation easements for some landowners around Southside Virginia. We live in a very rural area, and in a lot of ways we want to keep it that way.
You had mentioned how you don't consider yourself an environmentalist, and you're more conservationist, and there is a lot of push and pull within the environmental movement, whether hunting and fishing are part of that movement. And some people believe passionately that it should be a part of that, and some people believe that hunting and fishing should not be part of that environmental movement. Can you tell us how your time as a sportsman in nature has helped you get to where you are today and appreciate nature the way you do?
Yes, sir. Real briefly, without the hunting, without the fishing, I would not be nearly as knowledgeable about individual wildlife and the habitat that sustains them. From the early, early childhood, I'm talking about to when I was in the creek searching for crawfish when I was before the second grade, to now that I'm introducing the same type of things to my children and to others through the sport or through the heritage of hunting and fishing. I became so passionate about the outdoors and the wildlife that I want to give back to that. But I understand it. When I trap the beaver, I learn about how the beaver lives, how he grows his family, the habitat he creates. So when I trap a beaver, you know, I follow the game laws. I'm supporting the game department, which also supports the conservation and the natural resources. So I'm trapping a beaver. I'm using the fur, and in some cases, in consuming the beaver. It's not the two are not separate. If I could take someone who is completely against, who is an animal rights activist, if I could take them and let them walk in my shoes for a week, where they see with, as an example for deer management, if I do not harvest the female deer, let me tell you, I will not have a sound, healthy deer population. And why? You know why? Because the habitat has been changed from human encroachment, and the natural predation had been changed because us white men took away quite a large number of the predators. So we have to play the role. We have to play the role. Another thing, we are on the top of the food chain. But we got to play the role in an ethical manner. And, you know, the heritage of the hunting and the fishermen are the conservationists. They are the Theodore Roosevelts. They are the John Murrays. They are the people that started the movement to protect our natural resources and continue to. It's about being outside. And it's about introducing this exciting pastime or this exciting life that we lead to others.
Whoa, Rabbit Roy, that stock cowboy, he too much to believe. You know he always got an extra pack of cigarettes rolled up in his t-shirt sleeve. He's got a tattoo on his arm, we'll say, baby, he's got another one to just say. But every Sunday afternoon, he is a dirt track demon and his fifth is a Chevrolet. It is a Rabbit Roy, that stock cowboy, he's the best driver in the land. You know he said that he learned to race a stock car by running shine out of Alabama.
Follow The Shift to Sustainability with Sea Change Radio on Twitter at twitter.com/SeaChangeRadio and on our Facebook page.
My guest on Sea Change Radio is Ward Burton. He's a former NASCAR driver and now the founder of the Ward Burton Wildlife Foundation. Did you see anything while you were an active racer, Ward? And I know your son is a race car driver right now as well. And your brother, Jeff, is a NASCAR driver. So it's obviously pretty ingrained in your family, racing. Did you see any interplay between the environmental issues and sustainability and the world of NASCAR? Are there some strides that are being made in a positive sense, do you think?
I think there's some. I think it needs to be a lot more.
What kind of things jumped out at you as things that might have been wasteful or could have been improved while you were there?
Well, you know, we got to remember from where we've come. I mean, you know, our rivers and air certainly are a heck of a lot better shape than it was back when in the mid-60s, early 70s. So I think the sport is healthier as well. You know, you can't really blame the sport as much as you can us moving away from products that hurt the Mother Earth, one of them being fossil fuels. What just happened in the Gulf Coast? How long are we going to keep on doing the same thing to this earth? I mean, how long are we going to do it? Why are we not using the wind and the sun that's blowing out the window in this office I'm using more now? Why aren't we're starting to slowly have incentives to do this and that, but you know, it's going to take a mass amount of education and a mass amount of the government getting involved. My pickup truck out there, the 2500 Chevrolet, they have the technology to make that vehicle get 25 to 50 miles to the gallon and still be able to use it as a pickup that it's intended to when I need to use it and have that much power in that framework to pull something. So the leaders in the country have got to make it a priority.
You mentioned the federal government. Let's talk about that for a second. You also mentioned how in the 60s and 70s, the government took a lot of steps to clean up our air and water. Richard Nixon's administration, under that, passed the Clean Water Act, which has led to a lot of successes. But if you look at Nixon's policies today, they would be considered almost liberal by the modern conservative movement. When did the conservative movement and conservation seem to get a little more separated than the roots of the what it means to be a conservative?
You know, I'm not sure. I'm a country boy from Halifax County, Virginia. I read a lot about history. I've got a painting right here on my wall that goes all the way back to Thomas Jefferson. And he says, "For if one link in nature's chain might be lost, another might be lost until the whole of things will vanish by piecemeal." So that's one of our founding fathers, and I think from all the way to the beginning of our country to now, it's been a concern, but when does it become a priority? I guess that's my biggest concern. That's what my biggest fear is. It makes me want to have tears come down my eyes. When are we going to make natural resources a priority? Because if we lose it, who are we as a people? What do we become when we lose wild natural places and the large vast of wildlife that inhabit it? I don't know what we become, but it's not pretty to me. So when you come to the political side of it, I don't think any of them make it a priority.
Ward Burton, he's a former NASCAR driver, and he is now the founder and the head of the Ward Burton Wildlife Foundation. People can go to wardburton.com to learn more about it. Ward, thanks so much for being my guest on Sea Change Radio.
Hey, thank you so much. And to all the adults out there, please take your son or your daughter or the child that you're close to the outdoors. Introduce them to the outdoors, because without us passing the heritage down, we've got a bunch of kids out there with nature deficit disorder, and they're not connected to our real world out here. And we need their voice. We need it now. We're going to certainly need it in the future. So please think about that and consider taking them fishing, taking them hunting, getting them outside, and let them have a fun time in the outdoors.
Sway the future to the past and find what will endure.
You've been listening to Sea Change Radio. Our intro music is by Sanford Lewis, and our outro music is by Alex Wise. Additional music by War, Jim Croce, and George Jones. Check out our website at seachangeradio.com. That's seachangeradio.com to stream or download the show or subscribe to our podcast.
visit our archives there to hear from Bill McKibben, Van Jones, Paul Hawken, and many others. And tune in to Sea Change Radio next week as we continue making connections for sustainability. For Sea Change Radio, I'm Alex Wiseman.